的心都往心里 Couldn't hold him in the ground Couldn't keep him down Hello, everybody. Welcome. Hopefully this is mic is working properly. Testing 1, 2, 3. Welcome to Christianity 101 series on our Tuesday nights, continuing in our foundational series of Christianity, following Christ, and things like that. I'm excited about tonight. Last week was great. If you guys missed last week, last Tuesday, I believe, was 15 false teachings in the Christian churches. So if you guys missed that, definitely want to go check that out from last Tuesday. Address some topics that are simple to address, but some that are a little bit more not so understandable or being seen as often in a church today. So, well, how's everybody doing? Great to see a lot of you out there. Hope you're all doing good. Tell me how you're doing. I'd like to know how you're doing. We got Dizner, Janine, and Brian Davies, Mark, Brian, Awesome, Lawson. We got Franco in the house. We got a Jeremiah and others here. Great to see you guys. Hope you guys are all doing good. I'm doing really good today. You guys are going to laugh, all right? Can I tell you something funny? Okay, so today, my wife, I had to take her down to the dentist, and when she goes to the dentist, normally, just, you know, whatever it is, she likes to get sedated, so that way it all goes nice and smooth. So normally, I have to go drop her off, hang out for a few hours, so that's why if you saw that video I uploaded about an hour or so ago, I was down at the beach, kind of just chilling. And I was like, you know what? I'm gonna do like a 2-minute video. Why not? People always tell me, hey, Kelly, go down to the beach, do a short video. So there you go. So if you want to see a short video, go look at the video I just uploaded a little while ago called What is the Most Important Thing to Do as a Follower of Jesus Christ? And so I went down, did that, had a good time, and then went and picked up my wife, right? And then she was, you know, needed something to get, kind of eat. So we need to get like a smoothie or something easy for her to kind of go, whatever. And normally for you guys knowing me going through my diverticulitis and whatever else I potentially have, still figuring that one out. Be talking to my naturopath doc this Thursday to find out more about some other things. But last about 2 weeks, I've been just pretty much just drinking shakes. That's been my thing the last about 2 weeks or so, week and a half. That's all I've been doing is just shakes. And this last week, I've been drinking these shakes that are what's called Elemental All Biological Diet. It's basically like drinking the stuff in Matrix Part 1 when they're up in the ship. I think it's called the Nebuchadnezzar, and they're having those bowls. And that one guy says, all the body needs, all the amino acids, all that good stuff, you know. So I've been drinking that the last 3 or 4 days. And let me tell you, that thing messes up your taste buds because it does not taste good. But it must be helping my body because I definitely feel better, stronger, and I'm doing well. So saying all that, so as I'm picking up my wife and we're going, got to get something, you know, go get something to kind of drink, you know, shake kind of thing for her. And I'm hungry. And I'm not technically supposed to have like what you call normal food till probably the latter end of this week, right? To kind of see how things are. But I was hungry and I was like, you know, I need something. So we went to this place. It's like a raw and organic type of like, you know, natural place, organic, vegan. They do like rice bowls and shakes and all that kind of stuff, right? And I'm like, what am I going to eat? Like, you know, I need something, right? So I got a vegan rice wrap taco roll up. Yeah. So it's like a clear rice wrap kind of rolled up in concoction. So it had some things I had to have not in there, right? But it had like lettuce. It had the vegan quote unquote taco meat, right? Had avocado. And what else was in there? Was there any, and like a, it was a cashew sour cream. Those are the other things I had to, I couldn't have that I knew that would mess me up because it was some spicy other things, right? Anyway, so I had my first ever vegan rice wrap taco today. I was at lunchtime. I was a little worried. Slightly, because you never know. I'm doing good. And I'll tell you what, that was the best darn vegan taco rice wrap roll-up I've ever had. It's the only one I ever had. But it actually tasted good. I don't know if it means my taste buds are some completely off the charts or what, but it actually wasn't bad. I was quite, my wife, like, you know, she's like, are you feeling okay? I'm like, well, I haven't had real food in about 2 weeks now. My taste buds are shot. I don't know what, you know, the last 4 days I've been drinking this stuff that, like, you know, I just, you know, it's, whoo. Anyway, so anyway, Yahoo, huh? You guys ever had a vegan rice wrap taco roll-up kind of thing? Anybody out there? Hey, I guess like the expression say, don't knock it till you try it, right? So, and hey, it's Taco Tuesday technically, isn't it? So there you go. I'm keeping the tradition alive, keeping the tradition alive. All right, anyway, Jeremiah says, I'm glad that you brought this up, Philippians 2, 5 through 11, because I'm speaking to a JW about this now. Awesome. Is he going to be in this Bible study too? That's great. That's awesome, man. Great. Well, you guys excited about tonight? You guys looking forward to tonight's discussion? I hope you guys are. I got some notes today. Yeah, I actually was able to eat something solid. You know, like it's, I don't feel anything weird. Because normally when I've had food in the past and something wouldn't go good with my body, I normally feel it within about 3 to 4 hours. I kind of know, or sooner, I kind of know, uh-oh, something is not good. So I was happy. So now I know if I want to go get a vegan taco, I know where I'm going. That's right. You heard it said here. I can't believe it came out of my mouth, but that's right. Vegan taco all the way, baby. That's right. All right. Anyway, that's, I know it's crazy. All right. So you guys ready for tonight? You guys looking forward to this topic? I put some notes together earlier today for some slides. We'll be sharing some different information that maybe you haven't heard before. Some of it you have. got some resources that you might not know about, but they're good scholarly sources, things that some of you out there have helped donate to this ministry and support this ministry with different needs, helping me with my wife and I and bills. So much appreciate you guys for the support, really, you know, helping us out. It's been rough, and appreciate those guys who continue to help support this ministry, help pray for this ministry, encourage. This is a full-time ministry, guys. And some of you may not know, starting April 7th, first Sunday of April, I will be doing Sunday morning sermons. So it'd be at 9:30 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. And so if you're on the East Coast, then that would be 12:30. So some of you folks out there do go to church, which is wonderful. I think you definitely need local fellowship. I always want to say that's really important, have local fellowship if you can. Sometimes it's hard, right? Sometimes it's hard. And yeah, a lot of different things, my friend. Research, talking to people on the phone, Messenger, WhatsApp. Things that need to get done here and there. So I do different things. So yeah, throughout the day. Every day is different, but I'm always doing something, either talking to somebody, reaching out to somebody, looking up information for resources. So during my day, I also am quote unquote serving in different ways. And so it's not just when I do stuff online live. I'm also talking to many people throughout the day, you know, either praying for them, them even praying for me, praise the Lord, and trying to give people encouragement. So there's a lot that goes on behind the scenes that people don't even know about. So, but I don't need to go around, you know, boasting or bragging about that. It's just I do things, many things behind the scenes as well. So, but I got three or four streams to do live. So back to the Sunday thing. So I'm going to be starting Sunday. So for those of you out there who don't fellowship right now, don't have a local place to go, and you like to get a good Sunday morning, you know, I'm calling it the Bible Hour. What did I call it? The Bible Hour Sundays. Yeah, I know it's lame, right? But it's cool. So for some of you out there who don't have something like that, that'll be good for you. And if you have time to check it out, well, hey, check it out. Right on, right on. All right, well, let's get into tonight. So this is what we've been going through in our series, Christianity 101. So in the red, these are the things that we have covered over the last few months. We have covered in the beginning, going through the different, over the different weeks and months, what is Christianity and how it all began. Had a three-part series of who is Jesus Christ, knowing Jesus Christ. So these are part one, and then growing in Jesus Christ, part two, and sharing Jesus Christ, part three. So that was a three-part series there. And then I had a particular, teaching, if you will, biblical exegesis, what's known as inductive Bible study, where teaching some of the basics of who, what, where, when, why, and how kind of things. And I went into a really easy book of the Bible, John chapter 6, on what did Jesus mean about eating his flesh and drinking his blood. That was a really easy text to deal with, so you guys should have no problem with that, right? I think that was really good. I covered a hard section using the IBS tools, and I really hope that was a blessing for you who were there. Then the next couple ones, we went through what is the Old Testament, how the Old Testament applies to Christians. Looked at an overview as well as the New Testament. Okay. Sorry to hear that, Mark. Lord bless you. You should have a vegan taco, Marco. Try that vegan taco with the rice wrap. It'll make you feel great. New Testament books. And then I think there was a couple times where I wasn't able to make some Tuesdays. And then last week, dealt with the dangers of false teachers and false doctrines. And so I picked, there was others that could have been picked, but I picked my top 15 false teachings that are in Christian churches today. And I dealt with that. And so tonight, we are looking at Jesus Christ's incarnation. And so a lot of us will know that, have studied this somewhat. And like someone said earlier, you know, when you're talking to, you know, Jehovah's Witnesses, when you're talking to a Unitarian, when you're talking to a Oneness, this particular text of Philippians 2 definitely is looked at differently by Unitarians, by Jehovah's Witnesses, and even Oneness, because Oneness and Unitarians do not believe in the pre-existence of Jesus before his incarnation. Oneness believe he was literally the Father who became flesh and took on humanity. Unitarians believe that Jesus came into existence when he took on flesh. And then Jehovah's Witnesses believe that he did pre-exist, but he was a created angel known as Michael the Archangel. And what Philippians 2 does is it gives us a very good, concise, that Paul gave us this revelation, of course, through him giving this revelation for the Holy Spirit, of course, about who Christ was prior to his incarnation, who he was when he took on humanity, and then, of course, then his resurrection and his glorification of being that new glorified type of body, right? So that's what we're going to look at today. I hope you guys are doing well. And then, of course, I'll take questions and answers at the end. And I will also have a time of open mic for you as well. So for those who want to, you know, do questions in the live chat, you can. Or you can also come up on the mic as well towards the end. So this is Bible study night. I'll try to pay attention to the live chat. So just again, any moderators out there, of course, you are here to help. I really appreciate you guys. Thank you. If there's anything as an issue, if someone's being continually being something of an issue, a problem, you just let me know. Just say, put, you know, Kelly in all caps or whatever, and I can see it. And if not, I'll take care of it. But like, remember, no hiding or blocking anybody. That is me. So if anyone gets upset, they get directly upset with me. I was laughing because of the last night circus act with people coming over, and I had to block a bunch of people. They were on the other stream blaming other moderators. And I'm like, nope, that was me. I was the one doing that. So I want to make sure if anyone's mad, let them be mad at me. I'll take all the heat for you guys. You guys just do a good job just being in here, trying to keep things in order the best you can. And I really appreciate that. Lord bless you guys. All right, so let's get into it today, shall we? All right, so we're going to look at Philippians chapter 2 and go through this verse by verse. I'm not really going to jump around a whole lot. I might talk about some other verses here and there in general, but what I'm doing is I'm going Philippians 2, verse by verse by verse by verse, in a very simplistic, straightforward way. That way, when you look at it, you go, this is exactly what's going on. Because a lot of times what people do is they'll bounce a verse here and poof, 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 poof. And it's not necessarily always wrong, but what I want to do is I want to go through it consecutively. And so that's what's going to be tonight. I chose Philippians 2 for the main text. Of course, there's other texts as well. Hello there. And so let's get started, shall we? All right. Philippians 2, 5 through 11. These are going to be the main points that I will be emphasizing this evening. Talking about Jesus Christ, who he is. We're going to be talking about Jesus' pre-existence, before his incarnation, Jesus' humility and humbleness, Jesus taking on humanity, Jesus willingly, did I spell that right? Oh, I spelled that. No, I did. Willingly. Yeah, I spelled it wrong. Ooh, I thought I spelled it wrong. Thought that was a B for a second. Willingly goes to the cross, Jesus' resurrection from the dead, Jesus' name above all names. Jesus is Lord. All will bow to him, and every tongue will confess Jesus is Lord. Amen. These verses demonstrate the servanthood of Jesus, his sacrifice and resurrection, his recognition, and the unity of the Father and Jesus, the Son. So these are going to be the points that we are going to go through this evening. Now, what's always important is when you're looking at a text is you also want to see what's going on. So when we look at verse 5, it says this: have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. So what attitude was Paul talking about? Have this attitude. Well, this is where the verses before it, right? So here it is. Therefore, verse 1, Paul says, if there's any encouragement in Christ, if there's any consolation of love, if there's any fellowship of the Spirit, any affection and compassion, make my joy complete, being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. So notice here, there's this emphasis on love, fellowship, affection, compassion, joy, same mind, united together, intent on one purpose. And then Paul says, do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility. Look at that word, humility of mind. Regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. So here's where we see where Paul says, have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ. What attitude was that? Selflessness, sacrifice, humility, one who put others over himself. That is our example, friends, right? Christ is our example. He's the one we follow. We want to follow his example. We want to follow his instructions. We want to glorify the Lord, and we want to learn from his teachings. When you see throughout the Gospels, what did he do? He ministered to the poor. He reached out to those who were rejected or outcasts. He helped people in their needs physically. He helped, obviously, heal people, save people at times from their afflictions, and he showed them love and grace, mercy. And that's the gospel to which we want to follow. We want to follow Jesus. Jesus said, they will know your love. Sorry, I'm getting old. They will know you are my disciples by your love for one another, right? This is what sticks out as Christians, is that we want to uplift each other, uplift others. We don't want to tear people down who are our fellow brothers or sisters. Now, at times, Jesus rebuked and corrected false teachers and religious type of people who are opposing, as we also see with the New Testament and the book of Acts and from the apostles of Peter and John and Paul and others. We respond to those who are making opposition against the church, against the gospel. But we also want to be Christians who also follow the example of Jesus, wanting to show grace and mercy to people, especially to be a good example to the world and how we treat people. Amen. So here's where we see now Paul going on. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. So now what is he going to be teaching us about Jesus? Who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bond servant, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. I'm going to be dealing a lot with verses 6-8 this evening, really looking at this and looking at certain key words and their definitions, because there are people out there who twist definitions, right, and make it say something it doesn't say. So we're going to be looking at that. And then we're going to be looking at the latter half. For this reason also, God highly exalted him. And I always try to say this. This is talking about the Father, because you look at the end of verse 11, to the glory of God the Father. So God highly exalted him. The Father exalted him. That talks about his resurrection. And bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. To the glory of God the Father. So let's start looking at this piece by piece. Philippians 2:5-6. Hope you're all doing well. Welcome to the room. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God. So here's where we get the beginning of what we know as what's known as the terminology, the God-man, the hypostatic union, which is also taught in Hebrews 1:3, talking about he is the exact representation of him. The hypostasy is correct. He is the, by nature, one in essence with the Father. And Colossians 2:9 says that he is deity in bodily form. We know John 1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, and the Word became flesh, John 14, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So we see the distinction of the Father and the Son. But Jesus, who is the eternal Logos, who was with the Father from all eternity, he came in this world, was sent from the Father, came into this world and took on humanity and became like us. But here, what we see in Philippians 2, Paul says, who, although he existed in the form of God, let's look at the word existed here. The word existed here is the word huparko or huparkon. And this is what this is talking about, is the continuance. He existed. It's talking about who he was before and who he is now also in the flesh and who he continues to be in the heavenly realm now glorified. So here that word huparkon, the definition here from Pocket Lexicon in the Greek New Testament from Alexander Soter, a good scholarly type source, talks about the definition I am, denoting originally a state or condition still subsisting in contrast to what is temporal or accidental. In other words, when Jesus came, even though he existed or was in before his humanity, he previously existed, and when he came in this world, who he was before is also who he is now when he took on humanity, when he took on flesh. No different. He's still who he was before. Thayer's Greek Lexicon, many of you guys can check out online, Bible Hub, and you know, Interlinear, says here, to be in the form of God, Philippians 2:6, being originally. So this is talking about prior to his incarnation, who he was before, who he still is now, and who he will be forevermore. What does that mean? Here, talks about the word form, talks about who existed, right? Remember what we just looked at a minute ago? Who, although he existed in the form of God. So we just looked at the word existed. Now we're going to look at the word form. It's the Greek word morphe. According to biblical, or the Dictionary of Biblical Languages, Semantic Domains, Greek New Testament scholar James Swanson states, under morphe, in reference to Philippians 2:6, that meaning has the word nature, his character. So Jesus was in the form, or was by nature, God prior to his taking on humanity, but he was also God by nature when he took on humanity. It didn't change. This is something of his character, his nature. Alexander Sauter again, Pocket Dictionary of the Greek New Testament, states this, implying essential character as well as the outline line. It suggests unchangeableness. Unchangeableness. So this is talking about his nature, his character, who he was before he came as one, took on humanity, took on flesh. He was by nature God, existing with the Father from eternity. And now when he came on, took on flesh and humanity, he still is by nature God, one with the Father. Goes on to say in Philippians 2:6 here, the references in pre-incarnate Christ with divine attributes. Divine attributes, right? So now what we've looked at here is who, although talking about Jesus, he existed or has been existing, he was being who he was before, existing from eternity, was by nature God. When he came in this world, and he was the form of God, this is who he was before. And when he comes on and takes on humanity, he still is by nature God. That is his character, okay? But then notice the rest here. Now, here's the one that sometimes the Jehovah's Witnesses, Unitarians, and others out there will twist up a little bit. The latter portion of verse 6, right? Where it says here, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped. Now, this is where a lot of times different movements, Unitarians, Jehovah's Witnesses, and other groups, they will twist this a little bit or a lot. And they'll say, see, this cannot teach Jesus is God because here it says he didn't claim to be equal with God. It says the opposite, they'll say. They'll say to us who are, quote unquote, Trinitarians, who believe in the eternal existence of Jesus, who is by nature God. They'll say, see, he didn't claim equality. Therefore, he cannot be God, right? So what I want to show you guys here is the issue of that word to be grasped. To be grasped, okay? According to Dictionary of Biblical Languages, Semantic Domains, Greek New Testament, James Swanson, under this word here is kind of a funny one, so I'm hoping I'm going to pronounce this right, harpagmos, Harpagamos. Harpagamos. This word here has the meaning something to be taken by force, something to be seized, if you will, with the focus also of holding on to something, something to be clinging to, holding on to, not letting go. According to Pocket Lexicon of the Greek New Testament, snatching, robbery, an action of plundering, rapacity, or this last one, self-aggrandizement or aggrandizement. What does that mean? This is something that you want to hold on to for your own recognition, for your own type of presence, if you will. How you doing, Keith? Good to see you. This is where the humility and the humbleness of Christ is. See, those who go against the deity of Christ, those who use this text wrongly, who twist it, don't understand the focus of what Paul is saying here. Jesus is our example. Remember what Paul said? Have this attitude in your mind, in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. What's that? Putting others first, putting others above yourself. So Jesus, who has existed from eternity with the Father, who is by nature God, and he came into this world to humanity, and he still has the same nature, the same character, but now, for a time, he sets aside his recognition and becomes a servant for you, for me, for the world. He becomes a servant. This is why he humbled himself. So when it says he didn't cling to, grasp, hold on to, is because for a time he left the glory in heaven, didn't leave his divinity, didn't stop still by being by nature God, but the glory of which he had. We read about that in John 70, where he says, Father, glorify me with the glory I had with you before the world was. So Jesus, who is the ultimate example of humility, self-sacrifice, he comes in this world for you, for me, to die, to go to the cross, to make atonement for sin, and to save us through defeating sin and death through his resurrection. For a time, that glory, that recognition is set aside. This is what's going on with this meaning. But so often, when those are in cults, those who reject the deity of Christ, those who reject his eternal existence, they will twist this to make it say something else. Jesus was God incarnation. I don't know what time you came in here, buddy. Colossians 2:9, Hebrews 1:3, John 1. Jesus was God come in the flesh. That's why he's called the God-man. But that glory, that recognition was not seen. People didn't see his glory when he walked around. That's why people didn't believe him. Many people rejected him. Many people denied him. That's why he was humble, and he was always pointing that he was sent from the Father, came to do the will of the Father, spoke the words of the Father. Him and the Father are one together. And at times he even said that so often the cults will use John 14:28, which says, I'm going back to the Father who's greater than I. And they'll use that text to say, see, again, Jesus can't be God because the Father's apparently greater, right? Greater in regards to his position at that time, because Jesus was in the servant intercessor type of mode. But then he was glorified with the glory he had before with the Father in John 17, talking about after he was resurrected. The ironic thing when those people use John 14, 28 is in John 14, 12, he says, I'm going back to the Father. And he says, greater works than these you will do because I go to the Father. So if John 14, 28 means that the Father can't be God because the Father's greater, then it means we're greater than Jesus, according to what Jesus said in John 14:12. See the irony of how that logic falls apart? Greater has to do with in regards to with Jesus in John 14:28, positionally, because he came and humbled himself and took on humanity like us. The Father's in the heavenly realm glorified. So of course the Father's greater in that regard. But us, when he says we'll do greater works, because now when he gets crucified and resurrected, and we receive the Holy Spirit, we read in the book of Acts, then we as the Christian church go all throughout all of the world. So greater in that sense, because now there's so many of us going out. Everything has to do with context. So here's where we get more of this information now. So here now it says, verse 7, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bond servant, and being made in the likeness of men. So now what we see is he's now coming to take on this humanity, right? He's coming in this world, and he's going to be humbling himself. So he emptied himself here, right? He emptied himself. I'm trying to find my word for that. He emptied himself, taking the form of a bond servant and being made in likeness of men. So here's the word here. And it is, there it is. Okay. Whew. Kinu. Kinu. Has to do with position or prestige. So talking about of Christ here from what's known the BDAG of the Greek English lexicon New Testament, of Christ who gave up the appearance of his divinity and took on the form of a slave. He emptied himself, divested himself of his prestige or privileges. So Jesus, who is from eternity God, one with the Father in nature, for a time when he came in this world and took on humanity, he set that aside. He emptied himself. He put that aside and now came as a suffering servant, as we would see Isaiah 53, Psalm 2, other scriptures. Jesus came in this world and took on the form of a slave, a servant for us, and for a time set aside that recognition and glory and his privileges. For those who've been following from the beginning, is this making some sense for you guys? Are you guys following this so far? Is this making sense as we're walking through these verses and looking at these definitions? And especially the guy earlier who was talking, I think it was Jeremiah. Jeremiah, you still here? I hope you're still here, Jeremiah. Hoping this is making sense for you, Jeremiah, taking some notes. Here from the Concise Greek English Lexicon from Danker and Krug in regards to the kinu, to make empty the eye of the idea of emptying things of their content extended, deprive of prestige or status. So once again, we see this, understand this, what this word means is that he came as a servant, a suffering servant. He did not come in all of his glory, did not come with lightning bolts coming out of him and zapping people. He didn't come around saying, do this, do that. He came as a suffering servant, as an example to humanity. That's what we see the context here. So when someone says to you, this here says, he didn't cling to this, didn't hold on to that, didn't grasp this, emptied himself, therefore he can't be God, they're not understanding the point of why Christ came. He humbled himself, willfully and willingly came to go to the cross, to be resurrected, to deliver us from sin and death. And he did that because he needed to be that, become like us as a man, as an intercessor. That's what the book of Hebrews 7, 8, 9, 10 talks about, that he had to come as an intercessor, one who would be our mediator. 1 Timothy 2:5, there is Jesus Christ, our one mediator between God and man. So even though Jesus is by nature God, he also became like us, a man. And he is that perfect, sinless man who never had any defilement, no blemish, nothing. That's why his finished work on the cross is perfect and complete. And that's why we read in Hebrews chapter 9 that he is the very one that had to give a sacrifice for us, because God is the one who gave us the old covenant. In order for a new covenant to come into play, to being, if you will, the one who gave it must die in order to establish the new. And that's what we read in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 15 through 22. And this points again to the deity of Jesus Christ. And that's how he can establish this for us to be in the new covenant. As well, now this is a little bit more on the issue of his appearance. So it's a little bit of a Greek word from morphe to morphion. And here, what we see now, talking about his likeness, his appearance. So he came into this world, took on our likeness, but he was without sin. He was without blemish, but he took on us. He took on flesh, John 1:14, Hebrews 1:3, and of course here, Philippians 2. He had our likeness. The Bible says he was tempted in all ways, yet without sin. Yet the Bible also says that he had no sin. That's why he can be that perfect intercessor for us. No one else can. An angel can't. A normal person can't. Only the God-man can be the one who can set us free from our sins to be that perfect sacrifice. Jesus Christ, the Son, the eternal Logos, sent from the Father, came in this world, took on our likeness, was without sin, went to the cross for you and me, was crucified, resurrected, defeated sin and death, and for all who call upon the name of the Lord and are born again, are saved. Amen. As well here, similarly, likeness, appearance. James Swanson here. Let me just make sure I didn't go too far here. Yep, okay. Dictionary of Biblical Languages here. Similarity. Likeness here. Likeness, appearance. From the BDAG once again. I think I messed my notes up there. Pretty sure. No, that one. Sorry. This one is the concise. Sorry. This is the Concise Greek English Lexicon. I almost just messed up my words there. Danker and Krug. Here talks about a condition of being like. So again, something that he was like. He came in our likeness. He had the form and appearance as a man, yet without sin. This we see from these different sources here. Again, sharing things that are scholarly sources. The people out there want to bicker, whine, complain. These are solid resources from Greek scholars. Now we're going to verse 8. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself. So now what we see is he is that one, he humbled himself. Have this attitude in yourselves, which is awesome Christ Jesus, who although he existed from eternity past, he's always been one with the Father, always existing, who was by nature God. And when he came on this world, he still was. He was still by nature God, one with the Father, but he came on and was cloaked in our likeness in the flesh. And here's the beautiful thing. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. This is the gospel, friends. Jesus loves you, whoever you are. The gospel is for anyone. The gospel is that Christ, the God-man, the eternal Logos, the eternal Son, sent from the Father, came in this world, took on humanity, humbled himself for a time, set aside his recognition and his glory, his status, if you will, the suffering servant for you. And he went to the cross for you. He went to the cross for you. Jesus, omnipresent, Bible says, knows all things, can be in more than one place at one time. So if you don't think that Jesus is omnipresent, well, then you reject Scripture to the one who's typing that out. Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and last, the beginning and the end, according to Scripture. He's eternal. The eternal one. No. Jesus and the Father are distinct persons, my friend. They're distinct persons. They have the same glory, the same nature, identified with the same identity. This does not make Jesus the Father. That's oneness heresy. Oneness is not biblical. Instead of maybe arguing so much here, because I know I've seen you in the past, my encouragement to you ask is just sit here and just listen for a bit. If you don't agree, that's fine. That's fine. No one forces you to be here. No one put, you know, a spoon to your head and said, go to this room or else. So this is a Bible study fellowship night. So if you want to hang out and listen, you're more than welcome to. But if you're going to come in and just want to cause craziness, then I'm going to encourage you to stop, but I want to encourage you to also listen, okay? I'll give you a really simplistic answer. The Bible says that we are the body of Christ, those who are genuine born-again Christians. The Bible also says that we are one. Does that mean that I am you and you are me? Does it mean that I'm Joey? Does it mean that I'm Breeze? Does it mean I'm Lawson? No. We all can be unique, many members of the body of Christ in one. And if we can be, are you really going to say that the God of creation cannot be? You're going to limit the God of all eternity by your opposition? Right? Well, I've shared with you, my friend. Gave you a chance. Now, all you can do is just sit there and listen. All right, we're going to continue to move on. So here's where we see the blessing here. And thank you, Pers Taylor. Hope I say that name right. Lord bless you. Thank you for the super chat. Thank you. So Jesus, who loves you, loves those even who deny him, who loves people who reject his deity, love those who come against the Trinity. Jesus can save them if they'll just humble themselves and turn from their pride, their arrogance. Just see the beauty of the humbleness of Jesus Christ. See the oneness between the Father and the Son. See that oneness together in harmony. It's beautiful. Scripture is very clear on this. Now we go to the latter portion here. So that's the first half, dealing with Christ from eternity, who he was before, taking on humanity for a time, setting aside his glory, his status, his recognition. And now we're going to get to his resurrection. Now we're looking at verse 9 through 11. For this reason also, what reason? Because Christ humbled himself, because Christ was a servant, we see how the Father and the Son working together, God, meaning the Father, exalted him. Now, this is where this, see, when Jesus was here in his first coming, he humbled himself. He definitely claimed to be the Son of God, the Son of Man, claimed to even be the Lord of the Sabbath, claimed to be the I Am. They wanted to stone him and kill him for him claiming at times to be equal with the Father. But he didn't go around in public display and looking like this or that. He was a humble servant. But now he's resurrected, exalted. And now what we see the Father doing, bestowing upon him, now showing and pointing people to him, this recognition of who he was before as well, through his death, burial, and resurrection, now we see how the Father is now exalting and now bestowing, publicly saying, this is Jesus. This is the one whom I sent. This is the one who died for you, loves you, rose again. And now, as he's being exalted, glorified, as we read in other places, all authority, all power, we see he's declared Lord, declared Christ after his resurrection. We see now that all of Jesus' claims are now vindicated. They're proven. Because all, if Jesus, with all of his claims before, if he wasn't resurrected, he would be a dead, false Messiah. He claimed to be the eternal Son, claimed to be the Son of God, claimed to be the Lord of Sabbath, claimed that Abraham saw him, claimed to be the I Am, claimed that all are to honor the Son even as they honor the Father. He claimed, I and the Father are one. Over and over, we see this. If he was not resurrected from the dead, all those claims, even all those wonderful miracles that we read about, would just be a simple passing of a story. And we wouldn't even be here this day. We wouldn't be talking. But because Jesus lives and he is risen indeed, we come and celebrate his resurrection Sunday, this coming Sunday, right? That's why we're here. That's why we glorify the Lord. That's why we are so thankful that we are saved by grace through faith. It is a gift of God. We are not saved by works. We're not saved by our flesh. When we become born again, there's a change in our heart, change in our mind. We've now become reborn, born again, a new creation, and now we have this new life Now that God's working in our lives, he's transforming us. He's conforming us. He's working in our lives. And it's all the Lord. What's on us is we got to believe. We either receive and we become children of God, or we reject and we stay in our sinful state, and the judgment will come. That is the simplicity and the beautifulness of the gospel. So here, look at this. Bestowed on him the name which is above every other name. What? The name that's above every other name.
Wrong answer!
No. The name that is above every name. Jeremiah, if you're still listening, was talking earlier about, he's talking to some Jehovah's Witnesses. In the New World Translation, they put in there, with a bracket, every other in brackets name. Again, diminishing the deity of Christ, his equality, one with the Father. He has the name above every name. Friends, in Christ, what is the name above all names in the Bible? Yahweh, the Lord, the Eternal One. Watch this, friends. Paul is referencing in Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 through 11, 10, 9, 10, 11, he's referencing Isaiah 45, particularly verses 22 and 23. But I wanted to go a little bit deeper today and look at a couple other verses, a verse before it and a couple of verses after it. Let's look at Isaiah 45 today, which Paul is referencing in Philippians chapter 2. Verses 9 through 11. It might be something you haven't seen before. Something that popped out to me a little bit uniquely today, and I was pretty excited about it. Watch this. Verse 21. Declare and set forth your case. Indeed, let them consult together. Who has announced this from of old? Who has long since declared it? Is it not I, the Lord? This shows God's all knowledge. He knows the beginning from the end. He knows from eternity to the end of eternity. Nothing takes God by surprise. We see it. Isaiah 42, Isaiah 43, Isaiah 45, Isaiah 46. Passage after passage after passage. Even Jesus said it to his disciples in John 13. He says, I've said these things to you in advance so that you will know that I am. Whoa! He was referencing the I am of Isaiah in the different chapters. Who is this one who knows all things? Is it not I, the Lord? Try to stay focused on the same topic, guys. Is it not I, the Lord, and there is no other God besides me? A righteous God and a Savior? There is none except me. Who's the emphasis on here? The Lord. No other God, no other Savior. I, the Lord. Look at verse 24. They will say of me, only in the Lord are righteousness and strength. So what is this name now that is being bestowed or recognized so that people will know who Jesus is, that he has the name above every name? What name is that? The name of God, Yahweh. Now, he was already claiming to be the I Am, already claiming to be the Lord of the Sabbath, Matthew 12:8. We know he claimed equality with the Father in John 5, John 8, John 10, and other places, John 14. But here we see Paul saying, declaring this, he has the name above every name. That shows he must be one with the Father. Because he's not above the Father. He's one with the Father. You guys hearing this? Is this making sense? This is really neat. This is really encouraging. This is declaring how Jesus is one with the Father who has the same name. But he's distinct from the Father. Are you guys getting that? Is that making sense? Notice this here in verse 10. So that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. So Jesus, who has this name above all, is one with the Father. And that name, we know he is Lord. He is Yahweh. That's what Paul is going to teach here. Every knee will bow. Of those who are in heaven and on earth and on the earth. So we know the name of Jesus means salvation or deliverer, one who saves, Yeshua in the Old Testament. But here he has the name above all names. Every name must be pointing his oneness with the Father, and that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. Of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth. Let's go back to Isaiah 45. Look at verse 23. That to me, who's that speaking? Yahweh, the Lord. That to me, every knee will bow. Every knee will bow to Jesus. Paul ascribes in this context, this pointing to Jesus, who is one with the Father, and that every knee will bow. Talking about the recognition now, the status, the recognition of who Jesus is. Remember, when he came and took on flesh, he was by nature God, but for a time, set aside his recognition, his status. But now, once resurrected, he's now been glorified with the Father again and now being declared Yahweh, the name above all names. Every knee will bow. But watch this. And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So we know they're distinct persons, number one. Every tongue will confess Jesus Christ is Lord. That's in Isaiah 45 again. That to me, every knee will bow and every tongue will swear allegiance. This is talking about Jesus. This is declaring Jesus is Lord, one with the Father by nature, and distinct persons. But here we see because of his resurrection now, he's being recognized, his status is now he is Lord. That's why we read Revelation. He is the first and last. He is the one that every eye will see coming in the clouds. He is the Alpha and Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He is the one, the eternal one. And that's why we read these scriptures from the apostles. These confirm what Christ claimed, both his servanthood and his deity. But now watch this. Let's dig a little bit deeper now. I saw something today that I didn't see before in my studies. And I was like, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Hold on. Hold on here. It's time for Hulk Smash. Smash! I saw something today that kind of said, what? Let me tell you what I'm talking about. There are times in Scripture where we know Yahweh is speaking, but then he speaks of another in context who is also being identified as God or Yahweh. We see that in like Isaiah 48, Isaiah 63, Zechariah 1, 2, and 3, other places in Scripture, the Lord rained fire and brimstone from the Lord out of heaven. We see numerous examples in Scripture where there's a couple who are both being identified as Lord or Yahweh. And I was reading today and I was doing my notes and I went, well, that looks interesting to me because the verses before, it's I, the Lord, none except for me, I am God, that to me every knee will bow, every tongue will confess, they will say of me only in the Lord's righteousness and strength. But then look at the end of verse 24. Let's see if you catch this. Or maybe I'm an idiot. I'm hoping I'm not, because I was pretty excited. It says, they will say of me only in the Lord our righteousness and strength. And then what does it say? Men will come to him. Him. Not me. Not I, not you will come to me. Men will come to him. And all who are angry at him will be put to shame. Are you guys having like some big light bulbs popping right now? Because they sure did for me earlier. This is pointing to Christ. This is pointing to Christ. Now, notice in verse 24, it says, they will say of me only in the Lord. Look at verse 25. The wording's different here. In the Lord, pointing to the end of verse 24, in the Lord, all the offspring of Israel will be justified and will glory. Now, this is, of course, point in the Old Testament, Israel being the people of God. In the New Testament, we are Jew and Gentile. We are the body of Christ. Israel still is a recognized nation. God is still working with them, despite some people thinking they're not. God's still working with them. But now in the body of Christ, we are the church. We are the witnesses of Jesus Christ. Acts 1:8, we are bondservants of Jesus Christ. There's neither male nor female, free man, slave, Jew or Greek, we are all one in Christ. Look at this here. In the Lord, all the offspring will be justified and will glory. What is that pointing to, friends? That's pointing to Jesus Christ. In him, all who are angry or against him, they're going to be put to shame. Those who reject him will be put to shame. But those who are in him, in the Lord, those who are in the Lord will what? Be justified and will glory. Is that not exciting? I was like, wow. Praise the Lord, somebody. I read it over and over and over and over, and I was like, it is saying that. This is pointing to the coming of Christ. And let me back it up even more. Watch this. In Philippians 2, for this reason also, God highly exalted him, bestowed on him the name which above every name, so at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow of those who are in heaven, on earth, under the earth, so that the name they will confess, that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Watch this. Joel 2:32. Prophecy of the coming of Christ. We read about this. Quote, it will come about that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be delivered. Delivered. Praise the Lord, somebody. From Mount Zion and Jerusalem, there will be those who escape, as the Lord has said, even among the survivors whom the Lord calls. Peter, when he's given us his first sermon in Acts 2, when they're all saying, hey, you guys are all drunk. And he's like, man, you guys are out of your minds. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. You guys are out of your mind, man. What's going on? They're filled with the Spirit. And Peter gives this sermon. And what does he say towards the end of it that some people sometimes miss? He talks about all these different things. And in the last part of it, he says this. And it will come, and it shall be, that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. He was talking about Jesus. And to back it up even more, Paul says in Romans 10, verse 9 through 13, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, going back to Philippians 2, you will be saved. For with the heart, a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes in him, that should have been read there, my bad, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. There is no distinction, for there's no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, abounding in riches for all who call on him. For whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Praise the Lord Jesus. Praise the Father. Praise the Holy Spirit. Praise the triune God. Is that not exciting? I was ecstatic earlier today. I was ecstatic. This was great. They will say of me, only the Lord, our righteousness and strength. Men will come to him. And all who are angry at him will be put to shame. But in the Lord, so those who are in the Lord, old covenant or new covenant now, will be justified and will glory. So when we read here, Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Hallelujah. So as I conclude, we look at Philippians 2, 5 through 11, and we went to the verses before it. We looked at who Jesus Christ is and was and who he is. We looked at Jesus' pre-existence. Lord bless you, Kevin. We looked at his pre-existence before his incarnation. We looked at Jesus' humility and humbleness. We looked at Jesus' willingness to go to the cross for you, for me, for everyone. We looked at Jesus' resurrection from the dead, being exalted, declared the name above all names. Jesus is Lord. All will bow to him. Every tongue will confess Jesus is Lord. These verses demonstrate the servanthood of Jesus, his sacrifice and resurrection, his recognition, and the unity of the Father and the Son. Hallelujah. That is Philippians 2:5-11. I believe in context. When you look at other scriptures, of course, John 1, the prologue of John. You look at Colossians 1:16-17 about him being the creator of all things. Colossians 2:9, he's deity in the flesh. Hebrews 1, he is the exact representation of his being, the nature of who he is, one in essence with him. We see scripture after scripture, Christ as a servant taking on humanity, and who he was prior to his incarnation and who he is now, exalted and glorified. Amen. Well, that concludes tonight's lesson, study Bible, if you will, Bible study. I'm now going to leave it open for you guys for question and answers. If you guys want to have any questions in the text, feel welcome to. I'll do a little bit of questions from the live chat here. And then I'll open up the mic in a little bit as well. Amen. I love 1 Peter 3:15. Sanctify the Lord God, or sanctify Christ as Lord. That goes back to Isaiah 8:13, where the Lord says you are to sacrifice or devote yourself to Yahweh. Peter says the same thing in 1 Peter 3:15, that we are to sanctify, to consecrate, to devote yourself to Christ as Lord, pointing back to the Old Testament, Yahweh. Amen, amen. All right, are there any questions from tonight in the live chat? Any questions from you? Any questions? Any comments? Any comments? This is your time. As I always say, if you don't say anything, then you have to listen to me talk more. I was extremely happy. This stuff that I did today, I was extremely blessed. I knew that going into this study, I was happy about this study, excited about this study. I wanted to walk through it verse by verse, give you guys good, solid Greek sources. Hey, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Great to hear. Great to hear. Great to hear. Why do I support the Roman Catholic Easter, which is at least 20 days before Passover, 25 days? Well, so we live in a certain calendar today, my friend, that it's just the way it is all around the world. It's not the Roman Catholic calendar. It is just the way we world. There are different calendars. And yes, Passover will come a few weeks later. It's different every year. There are some times where it actually bounces on the exact same time. We have, of course, a 365 days in a year. They have a 360 and a half day calendar. So that's why. So dependent upon how the years and the cycles go around, sometimes we're on the exact one, sometimes we're not. But it's not because of the Catholic Church. That's not accurate. All right. Anybody else? Anybody else? Any other questions in the chat? Next week, we'll be going into a series of the next topic, which will be on the Trinity. So tonight, we were looking at the Incarnation. Next week, we'll be getting on the Trinity. They'll probably do a, I don't know how many. It'll definitely be a series on the Trinity, for sure. Going more in depth on the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit, things like that. Building off the Incarnation, of course, today. And then after that, you can see the other topics about the gospel, salvation and many other things like that. So, okay. Well, then since there's no more in the live chat, but I'm sure there'll be some here and there, I will provide a link for any Christians out there who would like to join for some time of fellowship, chat, try to keep it on the same topic as possible, something to that effect. Don't want to go too far off. I want to try and keep it on the same topic or something relevant. So if anyone would like to join, the link is there. And if you have any additional questions, you want to talk about the deity of Christ, feel welcome to. All right, so it's time for you guys. So here's the thing. This was my presentation. It was simple. It was straightforward. Verse by verse, gave you guys good information. I'm asking you kindly, Mr. Lucas, to get off that topic because that's not the topic we're talking about right now. Stay on topic. If that topic comes up on another stream, we'll talk about it. But that's a different topic right now, and it's distracting. So please respect that. Okay? If you want to come up and ask some questions about the deity of Christ, come up and have some fellowship, welcome to. If you want to come up and have some prayer, this is our Bible study fellowship night. So if you want to come up, this is your time. Come up and have fellowship with other Christians. Talk about what's going on. We can pray for you. So that means you have to click the button to come up here and join. All right. I just got a text here from somebody real quick. 1 second here. Let's just see here. Nope. I'm live streaming. So I guess the Tom and Jerry's crew are apparently doing another stream right now. So, but that's okay. That's okay. Let them look like fools. Let them look like idiots. That's okay. What we got here? We've got praise. Thank you. Lord bless you. Appreciate that. Awesome. Let's see real quick. I see you in the background, Kevin. Give me 1 second. Yes. Do JWs practice black mass by rejecting Christ in their annual? They left me a track to go there. I don't know what the term black mass is. Not sure on that terminology. But what they do, though, they do reject Christ. I'm gonna probably work on a video. Hang on, Kevin. I'll be right with you 1 sec. Don't go anywhere. Because they do a memorial every year. And only, quote unquote, their anointed group, what's known as the 144,000, but there's only like how many of our thousands left? Not very many. They apparently are the only ones who can partake of the memorial. This is not taught in the Bible. There's nowhere in the scripture says that only the 144,000. It's ridiculous. Number one, they completely twist that of Revelation 7 and Revelation 14, where that's talking about different tribes of Israel that God's going to use in the latter days. And it even says specifically they are men, not married, and they're virgins. Now, I don't know how all that works. I just know that's what God's word says. So that's not the anointed group in the 144,000 of the Jehovah's Witnesses. What they'll try to do is say, well, that's spiritual, but then the 144 is literal. But then how do you become one of the literal? And there's nothing in the Bible that limits to them, to that group. Jesus said to his disciples, come eat, take of me. He says in John 6, anyone can take. John 6 is pointing to the Lord's Supper. Anyone can take. Jesus says, I am the true food which came down to heaven. It's given for the world. Anyone can take, right? So they butcher that. So I plan on doing a video at some point. And there are others out there who have a few good channels. One channel called JW Escape. Her name is Elaine. She is an ex-Jehovah's Witness. Great channel, by the way. She actually goes through the Watchtower magazines every week through their literature, exposing their false teachings. It's called JW Escape. Highly recommend that. All right. Let's bring up Kevin, if he's ready.
Hey, Kelly. God bless, brother. How you doing?
What's happening, buddy? How you doing?
All right. Just laying down, getting ready for bed. I have to work a double tomorrow.
I've always said it. So when people listen to me, normally when I would preach in the past in churches and I serve, I always tell people, you want to fall asleep, listen to my sermon. I was giving you a teaching night, and now you're going to sleep.
Yeah. So
that was a joke. You're supposed to laugh.
Okay, sorry.
Man, he is tired. He can't even laugh at that silly joke, man. All right, go ahead.
Yeah. So basically, I just wanted to ask for prayer. So a coworker I work with, his name is Andrew. A few weeks ago, he brought up the subject of the Bible. Me and him started to have a conversation at work, because I usually work nights. And anyway, about a week ago, he got transferred over to the morning shift because someone else got fired. So I'm going to be having a chance to work with him again in the morning. And, you know, if the Lord would permit, you know, if we get back on the topic again, I'd love to have an opportunity to share the gospel with him. And I just ask that the Lord would, you know, lead me into the right things to tell this man. What seems like his name is Andrew.
What's his first name?
Andrew.
Andrew, yeah. Okay. Well, let's pray for him now. You open up in prayer and I'll close. Let's pray for him right now, shall we?
Yes, sir.
Let's do it.
Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for another day of life and all the blessings that you have given me and the things that you've been teaching me, Lord. And I just pray you continue to be patient with me, as you know, I'm a stubborn idiot. Lord, I'm thankful for the opportunity to meet new people at this new job that you led me to. And
Amen.
I pray that you just, if you give me an opportunity, Lord, to talk to Andrew again about the word, that I'd have a chance to share the gospel with him. And in a way where I don't lose my job. But please, Lord, I know all things work together for good for those who love you, it says in Romans 8:28, Lord. So Amen. I'm just looking at that. And I just pray that you draw Andrew out to yourself, Father. Amen. And I pray for Brother Kelly's health, Lord, that you continue to help him and guide the doctors, Lord, to treat him properly and cure him of his illness. I pray for a healing touch on my back, Lord. It's been doing a lot better, but as you know, that it still bothers me greatly. Mm. And just help me get through this, Lord. I don't know exactly what you got going on or what you want me to do. You know, I have plans, as you know, Lord. I wanted to start a business and my savings have been dwindling because of my sudden loss of a job. And I had to find a new one, set me back a little bit. But I'm just putting it in your hands, Lord. And I just want to pray for the needs of anyone in the audience. Amen. Brother Paul T, Lord.
Amen.
Who had to take chemo treatments. I pray for a healing touch on him, Amen. Lord. And I'll hand it over to Kelly. Thank you.
Amen. Lord, you do know all things, and you ask us to pray, and you want us to pray, and you bless us, and sometimes you allow us to go through, we know from your word, certain circumstances, sometimes certain ailments or certain types of sicknesses or whatever, but Lord, you're always still there with us, and you love us, and as Kevin said, you work out all things to the good for those who love you. Those who love you and who have also been called according to your purpose, Lord. So we glorify you, Lord. We thank you in the good days and the hard days. We know that you are always Lord. And sometimes our minds, our emotions, we can get frazzled. We can sometimes wonder what you're doing. And we just help us in that, Lord. We're just people that just sometimes we don't get it. And that's where we need you, Lord, and we submit ourselves to you. We bow down to you. We call out to you. We devote ourselves to you, and we just know that you're going to work it out. And we just pray for Paul, as Kevin was just talking about. We pray for anyone in the room right now or those listening later, for those who are suffering or have needs financially, whatever it is, Lord, just may they just seek you first. Seek ye your kingdom and your righteousness, Lord, as you say in Matthew 6:33 and 34. Put you first, Lord, and that you will be there with them. You know how to handle them. May we decrease and you increase, Lord. May, Lord, whatever sometimes we're going through, Lord, we just don't, We just don't say, whatever, and give up, Lord. But we just give us the strength. As it says in Isaiah 4, that you give us the strength that will mount up on eagles and we will soar. Or so you will mount up and we'll soar like eagles, Lord. And we just submit ourselves to you, Lord. Pray for Kevin and his back. Pray for him for his new job. Lord, bless him. Be with him. May he do his job. May he be a good employee. May he show maturity there. May he be responsible, even sometimes when it's hard doing a job. Lord, but he also may he be a good witness. And if he has to, share words. May he be a good witness by his example. May he be a good witness by him being there. And may you open up doors, Lord, for him to talk to this guy, Andrew, and others there. May it be in a way that's not a problem that would be an issue at work, but may it be a way we can build friendships and relationship to which maybe they can have, I don't know what they have out where he's at, you know, Dunkin' Donuts or something, or whatever they can eat out there. Hang out, go have some lunch, whatever it may be. May we all seek that, Lord, in our daily lives. May we seek opportunities to be able to minister to other people, Lord, for your gospel, because it's so good. And you love people. You love us all. We ask that in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Kevin. Go get some good sleep. And as always, if you need to fall asleep, listen to me talk.
All right. God bless. Good night. See you, Kelly.
See you, Kevin. All right. Mic is open. Anybody else want to come up? Anybody want to talk for a second? Prayer request? Now is your time. I'm not going to start singing. And I'm not going to blabber, just a blabber. I believe I was able to really share some good stuff, and I'm really enjoying all who come here. I want to encourage you guys to check out the previous Tuesday nights. Does anybody have any other questions? Because I'm one of those guys that just don't like just to talk. I like to share things that are on my heart, that I'm motivated to do, and at the same time to serve you guys. I'm here for you. This is my ministry now, full-time ministry. So if you guys have prayer requests, something you'd like to talk about, now is your time. All right? Praise the Lord. Kelvy?
Hello, sir.
Hello, brother. How you doing?
Hanging in there.
That's great. Hey, you know, people have sometimes asked in the live chat, and I don't know. And I don't know if you ever said, how do you pronounce your last name?
Saunders.
That's great. That one's a lot easier. Kelvy Saunders. Okay, that makes sense. I could totally see that with the spelling. I now got it.
No problem.
How do you pronounce the last part there? Is it Quayo? Quaya? I don't know.
I usually just do Quayo.
Quayo.
Kelvy
Quayo. So why is it that? Why do you name it that?
It's kind of a long
story. Really, okay. We'll keep it at Colonel Sanders. Okay. Got it. Okay.
It was from a video game, but it was also supposed to be from like a Lord of the Rings language.
Okay. Cool enough.
Back in the day.
All right. Fun enough. Well, what can we talk about, my friend?
I don't know. I'm from Baltimore.
Oh yeah. Were you in the area where the bridge went down?
Yeah.
And I just saw that in the news a little while ago, earlier today.
Yeah, it's pretty wild. It's an interesting feeling. And I'm imagining, you know, if me, who I'm just kind of like, you know, I don't usually try to get involved with, you know, these types of things, but even it's still like cast a shadow over my mind. So I'm kind of surprised at my reaction to it, you know, because it's not like it's like a terrorist attack. It's just an accident.
That was when I saw them say it's not a terrorist attack. I thought it was a terrorist attack. Wouldn't they do it like at 1 o'clock in the afternoon when it's completely busy and it's full? They at 1 o'clock in the morning, whatever it was, nobody's even hardly on the bridge.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it could have been like that. That's a blessing right there.
Yeah, praise the Lord. I mean, obviously, it's sad that six people died. I mean, that's still very sad, but. Yeah, when I saw that on the news, I was like, are you guys idiots? Like, who would even say something like that?
Well, there's lots of, you know, there's, it's, everybody wants to find the more excitement than what there actually is sometimes. Yeah. But it's interesting because now it's, what I'm hoping is that, you know, that I think any event that happens in somebody's life in general, you know, if we try to always veer it or kind of, you know, move it to where it's facing towards the Lord in some way, because the interesting thing, because this bridge here was very iconic. Like even like the first time I talked to my mom this morning, she was like, because she was like, oh, you were born the thing. And I didn't even realize like it was built the year I was born. Right. So she's like talking about how she's like, oh, I was walked along when I was pregnant with you talking to your uncle. And she's like telling me all these stories. And I'm just like, wow. Like, and then that's where it dawned on me this morning, like this thing. So now like, so a lot of places around like Baltimore where you live, like around the county and stuff, like it was situated in such a spot that where you always saw it. It was like this constant thing in the backdrop. And so now it's like, just like not there. So it's very strange. And so I'm just hoping like, you know, with this kind of thing, like it just kind of like, I don't know, jars people.
Kind of shakes you up a little bit now when you're going on a bridge, right?
Oh, for sure. Well, that bridge, like it, whenever you got to the top of it, actually you'd bounce because the whole thing.
I've been on bridges like it before. And you're like, doom, doom, doom. You're like, okay, is this a roller coaster? What are we doing here?
Yeah, but it was wild because, like, even like growing up, like whenever like visit my grandparents, like every week, like that was the bridge I would cross and go over it, and it was just kind of like,
yeah,
it's interesting. But yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Like, if I'm praying for anybody around here, especially the people whose families are affected by that, I mean,
amen.
Then you know that it's one of those things where it's like something, some kind of any kind of vast change, you know, good or bad. I think it's those things that lets us know how fluid things can be, you know, just like any kind of tragedy, you know, just like, you know, I just heard about somebody's family member passed away in like 2 days, like they heard about something was wrong. Oh, something's feeling not right. 2 days later, they're gone. And it's like, okay, these are the things that we train ourselves to not think about, you know, when we go about our daily routine, which is why we need to make the Lord part of our daily routine.
Amen. You never know when you're, I mean, you know, thank again, like it was a tragedy, you know, 6 people died. I mean, but you just, I take life seriously. When I, this is an honest truth. When I get up in the morning, anywhere I go, pick my wife, I actually literally pray when we get in the car. I pray, God, keep us safe. I pray, get us home safe. I really pray that every single time I get in the car or when I leave here, I pray for my wife sometimes when I go away, because I don't know what kind of cuckoo is going to be in the neighborhood and do whatever, right? I'm not fearful. I'm just praying, saying, God, please watch over me. Please watch over my wife. I pray for the people as well. I mean, that's something that we should just, I mean, it should be a part of our daily lives. I think a lot of times we take things for granted.
Amen. And the opportunity and the privilege to pray, to be with the Lord, to actually, and then if something, the way I look at it, if something does happen, you know, if you prayed, what more could you have done? If you pray, you know, rather than if you didn't pray, didn't do anything.
Yeah.
Then you pray to the Lord after the fact. And then,
well, in prayer, you know, I've talked about this, but prayer is like communication with God. Like even like what Kevin just said a little while ago, everything we prayed about and talking about now, God's not taken by surprise, as if like we pray for something. God's like, oh, I got to go write that down. Like, you know, God knows that. But like for us, when we pray, prayer is also for us. It's for us to keep in fellowship with God, to be one with the Lord, to be reminded of his word, to be reminded of his faithfulness. So a lot of times we just think we got to pray for such and such and do it here and there. But prayer is like a way of life. Like if, you know, especially for people who have, you know, quote unquote, I'm going to say this in the best way I can, good marriages, you're supposed to spend time with your wife. You're supposed to have good communication. You're supposed to have this time where you're just really connecting. Well, we're called the bride of Christ, right? Like he loved us so much, he died for us, Paul says in Ephesians 5, 25 and 26. You know, and so are we spending time with the Lord? He loved us. He died for us. So I think prayer, when we're talking to the God here, you know, is it should be something of a something that we want to do, not because all of a sudden, because of a certain circumstance.
Yeah, Absolutely. It is an opportunity for a relationship. It's what we're made for. We're made for a relationship. And even just like you're talking about with the Trinity, like there are certain things in life we're meant to have a constant relationship with. And if we don't have that relationship, we die. You know, we're supposed to have a relationship with the air we breathe. So, you know, breathe some healthy air. You have a relationship with the sunlight above you, you know, or if you're, like you said, in a marriage, how do you have a relationship there? You don't have a relationship by ignoring them. You speak to them, you walk with them, you do things with them, you know, same way with anything. So if we're living in the Holy Spirit, we should be begging God, let us inhale and exhale the Holy Spirit. And you know, I don't mean that pejoratively, like, you know, like a Pentecostal kind of thing. I just mean that.
I know what you mean. I got it.
And the same thing, just like with the Father above. May we always be aware of the presence of the Father and all things in our life. And if we keep him in mind, and you know, then it's not going to keep us perfect. You know,
no, we still fall short, of course, but it keeps us in check.
Amen.
It keeps us in fellowship. It keeps our mind focused on the main thing. That was like my little 2-minute video, whatever I did earlier, like, you know, different people will share things a little bit differently, but like if you're putting Christ first and we're decreasing, then that focus, that mindset, we'll be thinking of other people. We'll be praying for people. We'll be fellowshipping. We'll be spending time. We'll be putting our time with the Lord in prayer and reading and whatever else. If we're Christ-centered and focused and not me-focused, then our perspective and the way of life will be on the right track.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, by the way, I found this this work. You might have saw me talking about it earlier. It was from Hippolytus of Rome.
Yeah.
Where he literally talks about the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit and their personhood. Like literally talks about them being persons. And because he has a writing basically against monarchianism, and where somebody was teaching that the Father and the Son were the same person basically. And right. There's a whole writing, but my point is it's 100 years before the Council of Nicaea. Nice. I'd never even heard of it before, but he's literally in there talking about the Trinity. I know the Trinity was already spoken about by Tertullian.
He's talking about a lot of people for sure.
Oh yeah. And the Trinity, I mean, it's we all know it's described long, but like in the second century we see of it. So
did you see the video that I did a while back? Well, like 15 different sources, 23 different references. Yeah. Pretty nice. Yeah.
Yeah.
When I did that study, and there's actually many more I found since then, because I'll probably do another one. But when I did that, I was so happy, because I don't really up until the last couple of years anyway, I don't really do a lot of researching on church fathers, because it's just not been one of my things over the years. But there's always been this little thing about, oh, this group says this, this group says that. But when I actually finally did the research and looked these quotes up and verified and made sure they were right, I was like, yes!
Yeah.
This debunks every false accusation and claim that they say this came in the 300s through some councils or creeds. No, not only does the Bible teach it, but even these guys were teaching it way before all that. And I was like, yes!
Yeah, the more I look at those guys, and that's what long ago would keep me from looking at them, because I always assume that I'm going to find something overtly Catholic or overtly, you know, something where I'm just going to be like, look, these. But the later you get, that's more you are going to find that stuff. But those early guys, yeah, you're right. The more I study them, the more I'm just like, these dudes knew what was up. they were basically, they were just like you and I. They were trying to preserve the proper gospel, the proper teaching of who the Lord is, and the way that he's writing that in that year. He's not seeking to teach people the Trinity, because he already assumes that people already understand that the Father is God, the Son is God, and the Spirit is God. He already assumes everybody knows that. That's why you don't see a lot of writings about this is the Holy Trinity, because they assumed everybody already had an understanding of it to the point that they didn't need to necessarily articulate it as its own doctrine, because to them, it's like, of course, God is the Trinity. How else do you think any of this works?
Amen. I just put the video in the chat there, Eric B. And anyone else want to check it out? Definitely go check it out. I'll probably do another video down the road, giving even more. But I did that, I think, sometime last year. And I was ecstatic when I did that research. So no, yeah, it's good. And you've grown a lot, Kelvy. I think I've really, like, I don't know how long I've kind of gotten to know you, but when it, from the first time I met you till now, I have definitely seen a growth in you, in the way that you share things on your channel when I check it out from time to time, the way you talk. You know, I can definitely see that you spend time with God and your studies. And I just want to say that openly to you, because it's been really neat for me. And you don't need to hear that from me, but I just, I like to recognize people and share that encouragement. I've seen you growing, and I really think it's a blessing. I, you know you well, but just want to encourage you on that.
Well, no, that's a blessing to hear that, honestly.
Amen.
But
all right,
I'll leave you to it.
Yeah, talk to you later. Lord bless you, brother.
God bless you.
Yeah. All right, friends. The link is pinned in the YouTube. If anybody would like to come up, we've had Kelvy and Brian up, or sorry, Kelvy and Kevin up. Anybody else feel welcome to join? Ask a question about tonight's study, Philippians 2, 5 through 11, or something else in regards to that, or a prayer request or something like that. You know, if you want to talk about something, this is your time. It's been great. I appreciate when people come up and they want to share and talk what's been going on and pray for people. I think it's awesome. Seeing a lot of good chat live in the live chat, a lot of good things being spoken here. I'm going to highlight here. Rick says early church fathers were Catholic, which actually, yes, meant universal, not the Catholic Church with the Roman Catholic Church. He says you're a fan of Clement. Okay. And you got St. Clement's cross tattooed on your arm. Right on. All righty then. I got a turtle. If I ever get a tattoo, I'm going to get a turtle. Slow and steady, buddy. Slow and steady. I like turtles. Turtles are fun. Anybody else like to join the live stream? I'm going to give you guys 30 seconds to join. If anyone doesn't join, then I will conclude this evening and encourage you guys to come this Friday. This coming Friday, I got a special stream coming. Let me actually highlight this real quick before I do shut down. Let's just put this over here real quick. This coming Friday, I got this going on. I got a guy joining me. He is a former member of this church called the Shinchinji Church of Jesus. They are a cult. He is a former member of it, and he's going to be coming this coming Friday night to share. He's going to have a lot of good stuff there, so make sure you come this Friday, because it's a unique thing. It's not talked about much, but it is getting attention lately. They are a very deceptive cult, and the guy is a false prophet, and want to encourage you guys to come check that out. All right, well, listen, I really want to say thank you for those of you who have been here with me, praying for me, praying to the Lord. Shinchinji. Shinchinji. Say it all together now. All righty then. Yes. Thank you so much for those of you who are helping support this ministry through donations. If you'd like to do that through PayPal, GiveSendGo, it's in my video description. Appreciate always those who are here also helping with the different super chats. Thank you so much. Lord bless you guys. I appreciate you guys. I appreciate the encouragement. Many of you out there email me or get in touch with me. You leave comments. I appreciate that. I am doing better. It doesn't mean that my condition is left. I don't think you can ever actually get rid of diverticulitis, but you can definitely get it under control. I will be finding out more this Thursday if I have potentially Crohn's or what's called ulcer colitis. Don't know for sure. Don't know. We'll find out more. But right now I'm doing better. Like I said earlier, I had a vegan taco earlier, a rice wrap with lettuce, with vegan taco meat and avocado and cashew sour cream. And I'll tell you what, it was the best one I've ever had. It was the only one I've ever had, but it was actually pretty good. It was the first time I actually had food in about 2 weeks. And I was out with my wife. I mentioned earlier, she had to go to the dentist and we were getting some food on the way back. She needed a shake and I needed some food and I was hungry. And at home lately, I've been eating like a lot of shakes. And then lately this week now I get to have like soft food, like rice, like mashed potatoes or things that are really soft and easy to eat. But I was out earlier. I was like, you know what? I wasn't going to eat something really bad, like, you know, pizza or a burger. Cause I know that would mess me up pretty. I know that. Right. But I was like, well, Lord, this is vegan. It's not going to have all the other stuff. It's organic stuff. God be with me, please. And I had that around 12 o'clock. We're 9 hours later. Yes. So now I know if I want a good vegan taco, I know where to go. All right, guys. Lord bless you. We'll see you guys this coming Friday. Thank you again for the fellowship. I pray you were blessed by tonight's study and the different streams that I do. If you ever want to reach out to me and talk to me privately, because I do talk to people on Messenger. I do talk to people on WhatsApp, talk to people on the phone. Sometimes I'll even do like a StreamYard privately online with people. If you want to talk, send me an email, BereanPerspectiveApologetics@gmail.com. All right, guys. Lord bless you. And as always, may you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus is Lord. We'll be right back.